Good morning, church. I thought for just a minute when I walked out here that I was in a Baptist church. Everybody's at the back. Stand up. We are in the house of the Lord. We're happy to be here in the house of the Lord. We're going to sing about it this morning. Amen? Good start. We worship the God who was, we worship the God who is, we worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, he parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. Yeah. Let joy in the house of the Lord, let joy in the house of the Lord. Won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. Shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung up on that cross and he rose up from that grave. Our God's still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. 'Cause we were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. Sing it again. We were the beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by his grace. Let the house house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. Won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. Oh, shout out your praise. It's a great start this morning to worship. So glad to be in the house of the Lord today. You know, the Bible is very clear about our relationship with God. God is our Father. We are his children. In fact, God is identified as our Father 265 times in Scripture. John 1:12 says, "Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God." He's not just our Father, he is a good Father.
Jeremiah 29:11, one of my favorite passages, tells us, "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for good, not for disaster, to give you a future and a hope." Isn't that just like a father to want the very best for his children? A good, good father. Let's sing it.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. Oh, and I see many searching for. Cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways.
Sing that again.
You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect. Was
Romans 6:6 says, "For we know that our old self was crucified with him so that the body ruled by sin might be done away with, that we would no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been set free from sin. Now if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him, for we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, he cannot die again. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died, he died to sin once and for all. But the life he lives to God. In the same way, we count yourself dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires. Do not offer any part of yourself to sin as an instrument of wickedness, but rather offer yourself to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and offer every part of yourself to him as an instrument of righteousness. For sin no longer be your master, because you are not under the law, but under grace." That verse, or those verses, Romans 6:6-14 speaks to that, that in the name of Jesus, those chains are gone, that by his blood, your sin is wiped free, you're made white as snow, that your transgressions, your sins, everything, all counted towards wickedness is gone in the name of Jesus. Praise be to God. If you all would, bow with me. God, we thank you for sending your son to die on the cross for our sins. We thank you for the thoughtfulness, the love, the care, the support, everything you do for us, God. We thank you that we are able to sing songs proclaiming that news, that you have broken all of our chains through your son. God, we thank you, we praise you, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
You're welcome. No, I'm just kidding. In case you're wondering why there's grass on the stage, Backyard Bash is this Saturday, so I am your friendly reminder to tell your neighbors, anyone ages 3 to just finished 4th grade, that we have Backyard Bash this Saturday, 9 a.m. to 3:15. We have bounce houses and a wild exotic animal show, and most importantly, we're sharing the love of Jesus with them. Speaking of that, out in the lobby where there were envelopes for raising money for the bounce houses and animals, which, by the way, we totally covered. Thanks to all of you guys. I appreciate you so much. I have prayer cards for the weekend, and they say different things. Pray for our church, pray for the volunteers, pray for the kids. I want to encourage you guys to take one of each kind, and put them on your fridge so that we are constantly wrapping our church and our community in prayer as we come into this weekend. Thank you, guys.
Amen, amen. Well, good morning, church. Glad to have you here this morning. Those watching online, thanks for being with us here this morning. And as the video we shared there at the very beginning, we do want to take, because this weekend and what we've set aside for it to be, to remember those that have made the sacrifice that they have, those families that this weekend means, maybe things to us that maybe we don't understand, but because of the sacrifice that was made, the massive blessings of freedom that we have in this country, freedoms to do exactly what we're doing here today, to gather as we gather as the church, to come into this building to worship God and give him the praise and glory and honor that he deserves because of those sacrifices that have been made. So we never want to forget. We always want to remember that. And just to let you know, after second service today, if you'd like to participate, up on our boulevard at 11:45, the community, Williamsville and Sherman, they are going to be having their memorial service up on the boulevard at 11:45. It's about a 20-25 minute service as we continue to remember and give thanks for those sacrifices, if you would like to join us up there at that time as well. But I'm glad you're here as we're continuing this series that we've been in now for several weeks, talking about how do we live ready? How do we live ready while we are on this side of eternity? And we've talked about a number of different things so far, but ultimately what we're seeking to learn in this series is how do we respond well? How do we respond and ready for whatever this world has to throw at us? I mean, you know, when good things happen to us, wonderful things happen to us, you know, we give thanks and praise and glory and honor to God. You know, we want to, and it's easy to do. But what do? As we learned a couple weeks ago, like when Jesus was teaching in the Gospel of John, when he said, hey, in this world you will have trouble. So what do we do when sorrow shows up? What do? How do we respond when suffering and pain and turmoil is there, you know, within our life? Because we're supposed to, during that time, as well, give thanks and praise and glory and honor to God during those same situations and during those times as well. So we've been trying to unpack these biblical principles because, you know, God tells us, look at, yes, we're going to have trouble and pain and turmoil. We're going to have all these things happen, but don't worry. Why? Because he's overcome all that. I have overcome this world. And his promise to us, as we learned last week, was that when we decide that we're going to accept what he gives us, what we call that gift of salvation, when we make him what's called Lord, a word that we don't use anymore today, but that means we're going to make him master ruler over every aspect of our life, that when we do that, he will give us everything that we need that allowed him to overcome the world. He will empower us with that same thing. Today is actually what the church calls Pentecost Sunday, where they celebrate, you remember, when the Holy Spirit showed up on that first Sunday and empowered the disciples, gave them what they needed to go out and to teach and preach the truth of the gospel of Christ to who he was. Well, that's celebrated today, and we still have that when we make God our Lord. So like I said, we've been unpacking these biblical principles in the series from an internal perspective, knowing that one day, the Christ that came and walked and taught and shared with us how we are to live our lives, he's going to return. So we need to be ready for that return. And today we're going to focus on practical responses to things we both personally witness and see and hear about in this world around us and the lives of others. Because the truth is, we have so many inputs in our lives, do we not, today? I mean, and sometimes the amount of information coming into us, the amount of information that we are hit, it just can be overwhelming. Not to mention that a lot of the information today, sadly, in the forms that it comes into it, can be so negative or so frustrating or so alarming. So how do we respond with it? I mean, how are we supposed to respond to that? How should we handle it? How are we supposed to respond in a righteous way to this world that seems so confused at times and frustrating? And sadly, today, we see people responding in ways that, you know, sometimes are very destructive. I remember I had a friend many, many years ago. You can look up when this movie came out. I think it was around 92 or 93. And that Michael Douglas was in this movie called Falling Down. And basically, it was a movie where Michael Douglas's character lost everything. Family, job, the whole nine yards, just was losing. There was all this injustice that was happening to him, and he was losing everything. And on this particular day, what kind of was a straw that broke the camel's back, he is driving along, got a flat tire. He's out on this day. It's like 100 and whatever degrees, and, you know, about that, and humidity and stuff. And he just, all these things are happening. So he decides he's going to take on, and he's going to deal with the injustice in the world, the things that he feels was wrong. He's going to go after him and attack the injustice, and he does it in a very bad, negative way. But I share that because when I watched that movie, I remember thinking, man, I'm glad that doesn't happen in our world. That doesn't happen in our country. You know, and I look back and think, man, I was pretty naive in 1993, because sadly, those things do happen. And since that movie's come out, and since that time, you know, there have been many incidences like that where people have tried to take, you know, justice into their own hands and, for whatever reason, do things that have hurt people in even greater ways than anything in that movie. But again, I say all that because it's in those moments we have to decide, how are we going to respond, big and small, okay? Because in the life of a believer, it's important that we determine in advance how we respond to these things, because our present scenario will often determine our actions. I mean, for instance, you know, we've come together as the church in this building right now. So we're focused, you know, I believe on the same God, singing the same songs. And it's an understood principle that when you come to church, that's what you'll get and practice if you so choose. But in a situation when there is wrong being done, right before your eyes, you know, certain aspects will sway us, you know, to one course of action or to another. Because like we say, you hear it all the time, people agree, we live in a fallen world. You know, where, like we said, we'll experience trouble, and we need to be ready to respond in righteousness to that. So I don't, no matter what it is, you're sitting there and or standing there going out for a walk or whatever, and you see somebody come by and they grab this lady's purse and take running, you know, there's wrong that you know that's not right to steal. You know, how do we respond? How should you? I mean, do you go chasing this person? What are people going to think? They see me chasing down, you know, how do you respond? Or maybe, you know, at work or at school, you have a scenario, a situation that's happening that you know is wrong, okay? But you wonder, man, what's it going to feel like to be viewed as the odd person out that doesn't agree with and doesn't go along with what everybody else is saying or what everybody else is doing? So what I want us to do in the rest of our time together today is, how can we ready ourselves in advance so that we can respond well to life's circumstances with a deep faith and hopefully strong convictions? And in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 13 and 14, Paul says this: be on your guard. Stand firm in your faith. Be courageous. Be strong. Do everything in love. All right? So what Paul started to say at the first part of this verse is what he's trying to tell us to do is, you and I, if you're taking notes, and I apologize, we accidentally handed out last week's notes. So if you're looking there and I've got May 21st notes and you would like May 28th notes, let me know, okay? And we can get you May 28th notes. Otherwise, I'm sure you got a great memory and you'll write all this down when you leave here with it. So I apologize. But God says, Paul was trying to say that we need to stand out. You and I need to be willing. Those that call themselves Christians need to stand out. And the place that Paul has encouraged us to start in this discussion is to be on guard. But how do we do this? I want to take what I talked about last week and kind of illustrate it a little bit more here, and that'll move this out of the way so you can kind of see, all right? I'm going to give an extremely simplistic illustration. I'm going to ask you some questions. These are not trick questions, okay? So you can answer. I'm not going to have you call out an answer and go, ha-ha, you're wrong. I'm not going to do that to you, all right? I mean, I like to do that, but I'm not going to. So here we have a pitcher that's full of what color water? Anybody? Blue. There's always one, all right? That's why he's an intern. We are teaching and training and helping him to learn, okay? Yes, there is a pitcher full of red water. Okay, that's awesome. Now, in this glass, we have nothing. Okay, air. Thank you. Thank you. All right? Such a scientific group here this morning. We have air in this glass, but when I go to dump this glass out, okay, that's my first service. When I go to dump this glass out right now, what's coming out of it? Air, okay? Nothing is coming out of it, correct? All right, but if I do this, okay, what is in the glass now? Vodka. I'm not Jesus. This is not a magic trick. This is not miracles. I'm not turning the water into wine, okay? I feel like I need to right now so I could down it with this crowd he brought me. Thank you, Jesus. But anyhow, we have, I'm just not going to ask questions anymore. We have red water, okay? So if I take and dump this out, I'm going to get coming out of it, of course. What's going to come out of it is red water. It's not going to be vodka. It's not going to be wine. It's going to be red water that comes out of it. Being on guard, as Paul says, means that we become extremely aware of that which we are allowing into our life. Because truly, whatever we allow into our lives will come out of our lives. Like I said, we talked about this concept last week as well. And I want to reread for you the verse from Proverbs, you know, that I brought in from Proverbs 4:23 that says this: above all else, guard your heart. Why? For everything you do flows from it. Like I said, as we talked about last week, our hearts are extremely important. And why do I give sometimes people give me a hard time about such simplistic illustrations. I mean, no-brainer, nobody. I did not teach you anything here. None of you are going, whoa, you know. I have seen something and heard something today. I did not give you anything new. It's extremely simplistic. But for me, I think sometimes some of the most simplistic illustrations become the most powerful in our lives. Because here's the thing. We agreed, most of us, you know, that this was red water, nothing in the cup, pour red water into the cup. Now the cup has red water, and the only thing that could come out of that cup is red water, because that's what we poured into it. A very simplistic illustration. We know that to be true. We don't argue with that. So the question then comes, and I guess to be honest with this, that if we agree with what I just read there from Proverbs, that the heart and how important it is that we protect what we're letting into our heart, why don't we apply that to our walk with Christ in our spiritual journey? Because the same is exactly the truth. This is what Christ says about the heart. This is what God says. Look at what you're pouring into the heart. That's what you're going to get out of it. It is the wellspring of life. All right. And today we say to ourselves, oh, I can watch this. I can read this. I can listen to this. It will have no effect on me. And we struggle and wonder, why are our churches hurting today so much to stand for truth? Well, what have we been pouring into us? We've been pouring the culture into it. So what's coming out of us? Not Christ, but the culture comes out. Because we've been letting the culture say, well, this is what you should believe. We've been letting the world say, this is what you believe, not the Word. So we're not pouring Christ and the Word into our lives. We're pouring the world and culture into our lives. And we struggle in the church. Well, doesn't, and you know, the things that we talked about, that's there. And we struggle to understand, you know, the importance of what that means within our lives because of what we're pouring in to our lives. And yes, you know, we're not going to be perfect, all right? We're going to make mistakes. But Jesus, he gives us a model to holy living. And that is to pursue that which is best, no matter the cost. You know, even if that means standing out. When you and I decide to say no to something so we can say yes to other things, it will get the attention of other people. Some, it gets their attention and they are not going to want anything to do with you. Because maybe they don't understand, maybe they don't agree, maybe they don't like, maybe they're scared. I don't know. They're just going to say, you know, that's just, they might label you as weird or weirder than normal, whatever that is. But others, they're going to look at you and say, I don't know how you did that, but I want what you have. I want what you have within my life. And over time, the Holy Spirit will more and more light us on fire with passion for the gospel message, even to the point where at times we don't have to say the words. It's the best way to communicate the truth, but just the way we live our life. I like what, at the beginning of the series, I shared with you about John Wesley, the pastor many years ago who's known for starting the Methodist Church movement and everything. He made this statement. He said this, light yourself on fire with passion, and people will come from miles to watch you burn. And that's the truth. You know, fill yourself with this passion and people are going to come. Some might not, but many, many will. The problem is, again, like I said today is, you know, what we look at and what we're being instructed to how to handle these situations, we're not preparing ourselves to live ready. So when situations pop up in social situations where we should help, we respond wrong. I mean, watch this 40-second clip from this movie about this guy named Otto here. Okay, so you get frustrated watching that because you're thinking, are you serious? But see, in our culture today, don't miss the picture. We got to get that on TikTok. That's got to be Instagram. We got to be, this could, you know, snap. And here we have this scenario. We're in the social setting, in the setting to help. And the right thing to do is to help the guy, but it takes an 80-year-old guy to help an 80-year-old guy that's out there because everyone else is listening to what the world says is important. Get in the picture. Get in the video. But when we fill ourselves with passion, especially passion for Christ, you know, that's there, people are going to want to know just as well. They're going to want to understand. I mean, remember when the revival broke out at the college and was going for weeks and weeks and weeks? People came from all over the world to see what is so passionate, what's happening in that chapel, that those kids are staying there, you know. Right or wrong, whether you agree with what was being said or not, there was something happening that caught people's attention that they wanted to be there. And when we're talking about living ready for Jesus Christ, I wonder what would happen. I wonder what it would look like in our church. And I'm not just talking about Williamsville Christian Church. I'm talking about the Big C Church, those who say that they believe in Jesus as their Lord and Savior. I wonder what would happen in our church, our community, our village, our county, our state, if we as God's people decided to deny ourselves of everything that wasn't good for us, that was offered to us, because we were so consumed with the passion of Christ and guarding our heart, and guarding our heart. Well, I got to keep going here. Secondly, stand firm. Stand firm. Stand out, stand firm. After grasping the concept of being on guard, responding well in life doesn't just stop there, because as Paul says, we must be willing to stand firm in the faith. And when I hear this, stand firm in the faith, one of the things that keeps coming to mind, and when I first watched this clip, it made me think of what Paul was talking about here. Watch this Al Roker clip here real quick.
You wish you had your weight back. Right about now, I do.
Oh.
Oh.
You okay?
We're okay. We're coming inside.
Yeah, do that.
Yeah, that's
that,
a good
Al.
Idea. That's
Wouldn't
a good idea.
Wouldn't it be easier if he just held on to that wrought iron gate behind him?
Yeah, I don't think there are a lot of people.
Okay, now you're used to when hurricanes or storms come up, we see weathermen and women, you know, they'll go out and stand in these storms, you know, to kind of help you understand the power of the storm. And this is an old hurricane that, you know, Al Roker was there. It was after he lost a ton of weight, you know, and there, but he's standing there in these 75 to 100 mile an hour gust of wind, so we could see it was there. And I kept thinking, you know, as Paul tells us to stand firm, you know, and everything, you know, Al was trying to stand firm there so much to the point he lost all this weight. He had another guy with him trying to help anchor him down so we could stand firm and deliver the news. But and why I think of that and what relates to me is, it's like the problem was, he was anchored to the wrong thing. He was anchored to something that, yeah, it might have helped him a little, but when the true storm showed up in his life, when those winds really hit the force that they could, it wasn't the right thing to be anchored to, and it blew him down. And so many people today, we anchor ourselves to the wrong thing, and the storms of life show up, and we forget that it's God that we should anchor ourselves to, because he promises the power to withstand whatever storm is going to come our way in our life. And the thing that we can hold on to as true followers of Christ in our faith, I heard it put this way, the hope that we can have in Jesus sounds like this. What I'm currently experiencing is not the end. Whether it's good or bad, storm or whatever, what I'm currently experiencing is not the end. There is a God whom I serve that is always working for good and his glory. Stand firm in our faith is essentially relying on God's word to be our guide in life, you know? And like I said, we just talked about being on guard, which would mean not allowing certain things to come into our lives. But the next step in the process of responding well to situations in life is knowing and defining what guides you, what guides us. Jesus, or God says, I want my word to guide you. That's why the psalmist wrote in the 119th Psalms 105, he says this, your word is a lamp for my feet, a light for my path. So having a lamp, having a light means that there's going to be those times where we have different levels of darkness come into our lives. Many things we experience in this life could potentially serve as darkness to us, but praise God, he has provided us a source of life, you know, a source of light that can be in there that we can experience even before the darkness. Reading, studying, meditating on God's word, on God's voice is part of helping us help to decide how we're going to respond before we are faced with a situation that needs a godly response. See, this is my friend, this is truly the make or break in our lives of those who decide to follow Jesus. Knowing him, surrendering your life to him, making that public profession of faith, entering the waters of baptism, great, great start in your walk in life and faith journey without a shadow of doubt. But following him daily requires one foot in front of the other, you know, every moment of every day. And community is extremely important in this process. I mean, after all, who's Paul writing to? He's not writing to one single individual when we're reading there from Corinthians. He's reading to the body of Christ in Corinth. He's reading to a group of people, because we stand firm together. That's how we're created to do it. That's why we're always encouraging you, not just, yes, take time alone to read. Take your time and get along with God's word and to study and to read and to pray and to meditate on it, but also find those that you can get with to study, to read, to meditate on God's word together. Because it's not just for you, but it's for everybody. And you never know when you come together, we never know when we come together in community, the impact that it will have on people's lives. Whether we get to hear it, I wish we could hear it, you know, and sometimes we're blessed to hear it. This past week, I was extremely blessed. There was, about 9 months ago, there was a gentleman who was in my youth group when I was in Iowa. He got a hold of me and he said, hey, you know, we were talking and stuff, and, you know, he needed some help in his life. He was kind of gotten off track. He wanted to know if I'd meet with him, you know, monthly or whatever, just in a Zoom meeting because he lives in another state. And said, will you just kind of meet with me and we can talk and we can share and we can pray and just work through some. And I was like, absolutely. And we've been doing that a little over the last 9 months. Well, last week was one of the times that we got together at this meeting and he was sharing with me. He was sharing this encouraging story with me. He said, I got to tell you something, Dave. He said, my job had me go to the East Coast this past, about a month ago. I had to go out to the East Coast. And he said, when I was there, there was a kid that he graduated high school with that after the kid went to college, you know, went out to his job in the East Coast, has been there ever since, and they hadn't seen each other hardly at all, and he knew he was going to be out there, so he connected, and they got together for supper. And they're sitting there talking, and the guy that I've been meeting with for 9 months, he said, all of a sudden, my buddy that I hadn't seen in a long time, he just looks at me and says, hey, you remember those times when we'd go to church there, and we'd go to youth group with Dave Beals? And my buddy was floored that he even remembered that, let alone was bringing it up. And he started to talk about his life back in Iowa, about the family that he had and who his dad was and things that none of us knew and the storms that were there in his life. And he started to share about how coming together in that youth group and being there with his peers and being there with these adults, how that blessed him, how that gave him a firm foundation to anchor to that none of us even knew was happening, but yet we were providing for him. So when I share stories like that, it's why you hear me at times, I'm very, very, very unapologetic about challenging you. I may be apologetic about the way I challenge you at times. Sometimes I get too passionate. But when you hear me stand up here and talk about being involved, hey, guys, we got this at Men's Night Out, or hey, ladies, you got this at this Bible study, or you have Austin or you have Scarlett stand up here and talking about an event coming up here, and I challenge you and I encourage you to become and be a part of it. It's why I unapologetically do not worry. I don't care if I have to guilt you, shame you, whatever. I want you to do it because you love Jesus. But we just get so consumed with self, with who we are. We get so, because what we're asking you to give up is the most precious thing. You know, to go on a missions trip, you know what you have to give up? A week of your time. To go at a men's night out, you know what you got to get up? Well, give up? I know what I got to give up. I got to get out of my comfortable recliner. On Monday night, sometimes I'm dead tired. And I got to give up my time. I don't want to give up my time. I want to stay there and sleep. Me, myself, and I wants to sleep. Besides, the restaurant we're going to stinks. They have horrible food, okay? And they're expensive. You know, all that combined together, I don't want to. It isn't about what David wants. And it isn't about what you want. Because you never know the impact that you're going to have on that child's life when you get called to be a part of Backyard Bash, a missions trip, weekly men's or women's. You have no idea the impact it can have when we're there, you know, when standing out and standing firm and being involved. It's not just about us, it's about everybody else that's there. And we do all that so we can do this last thing here. I got to keep moving on. I could go on and on, but got to stand for love. And I realize love today is a very popular word, and we connect love to so many different things, you know. We love this, we love that. We have our own agendas and desires and current relationship circumstances that we'll use the word love to define, but we have to look at what Paul uses a word for love here that's a Greek word that people say all the time. They don't even know they're speaking Greek when they see agape. That's the kind of love that Paul's talking about. That's the kind of love that God had for us, the sacrifice that he made. And he says, and that's the kind of love I need to have for everybody around me. That kind of sacrificial agape type of love for everybody that's there. And so Paul says, listen, when we stand up, when we stand out, when we stand firm in our faith, we must do everything in love. everything in love. And I know many of the situations that maybe you've been thinking about during the sermon are directed towards someone else. I mean, for instance, the injustice we see in our world today. And it comes in many forms, but we as God's people can pour into those things. We should pour into those things and bring the light of Christ. But this point, however, has more to do with situations directed towards us. It has to do with responding with forgiveness, you know, when it simply doesn't make sense. You know what I mean? I mean, this is what Jesus says about forgiveness. Remember Matthew 18 when Peter's talking? Then Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother or sister who sins against me? Up to 7 times? And Peter thought he's being generous because the law didn't require that much, so he's going above and beyond what the law requires. Okay? Thinks he's being generous, and we know where Jesus went on with that. But just like our other responses and situations, we have to be willing to know, how will we respond in advance? So when someone wrongs us, how will we respond? You know, will we continually, constantly hold that wrong against them? I mean, how many times have you said, maybe yourself, or heard others say, oh yeah, I'll forgive them, but I won't forget? And what you mean by that is, I'm going to hold this, every opportunity I get, I'm going to get this up and throw it in your face and stuff. Because that's a very truthful statement. We're not Jesus. And when you're greatly wronged, you won't forget. But we're to forgive. We're to forgive. And every time we remember, we also need to remember the forgiveness of one. Now, that doesn't mean we let them walk all over us. That doesn't mean we continue to take the abuse. But, you know, we forgive. Because, my friends, we're all broken. We're all broken, sinful creatures, which means that sometimes we all will fall short of that glorious standard. But through the power of the Holy Spirit that was given out on that first Pentecost Sunday and has been there ever since, that promise that Christ has made, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can be people who forgive and showcase Christ's love through our actions. See, love is the way that Jesus responded while on earth, and it's the way we're called to respond as well. So as we come before these elements here this morning that are elements that are there to remind us of the greatest love of all, God giving us his son, sacrificially giving us his son to shed his blood on the cross for us, to cover our sins, and what that means to us as we take this time that the church calls communion, and we take these elements that remember the body and the blood of Christ and what that is. Yes, we need to make sure that we are ready in our soul, that our hearts are ready for whenever Christ comes back, that we're ready to go and spend eternity with him. We also need to make sure we ready our heart, meaning we're putting those guards up to protect us so we know what we're allowing in, so we know actually what's coming out of our lives. But we also need to ready ourselves to respond in any and every situation with a Christ-like attitude in our lives. And yes, it will not be easy. And no, it does not come naturally, okay? It's something that has to be learned. But just like anything else, the more you practice it, the better you will become. And remember, we are in this together, all right? We are in this together. So if you need help, whatever that help might look like, you know, my encouragement always is to please humble yourself in the sight of the Lord and reach out and ask, all right? Before you leave today, we're not called to walk this path alone. So as you come and you partake and you take these elements, you take the two cups, you go back to your seat and you sit and you remember and give thanks and celebrate, let God's Holy Spirit speak to your heart as always. You know, are you willing to stand out? Are you standing out? If not, why not? Are you standing firm? Can you stand firm? What is it you're allowing to pour into your heart? When you look at your life, what is the wellspring of life that's coming out of you? And what are you seeing that's around there? If it's not Christ, why not? Let the Holy Spirit speak to you and take some time. And if you want to talk with someone, pray with someone, if you're watching online right now and you want to call in and chat with us this week, you know, find us out. We want to be there, as I always say, to do life together. But let's go before him right now. Father, I thank you so much, as always, for this time that we could gather, we could worship through song, Father God, through our giving. We can hear your word and be reminded of your word and the blessing that is in our life and be reminded of how we are to live our life. And in this time that we could come together right now, that these elements, what they resemble, what they help us remember, and Father God, the sacrifice that was given. I thank you and praise you so much for all of this that happens here, Lord. I thank you, Father, that we have you that we can turn to, that is willing to be a part. Just speak to our hearts now, Father God. You've promised so much to us, and you're willing to give so much to us. And forgive us in those times we haven't turned. But Father, right now, help us to clearly see. Do we understand? Are we standing out? Are we standing firm? Or, Father, have we placed you in our life where you need to be so those things can be done? Father God, thank you again. Thank you for the truth. Thank you for this time that we could celebrate in your presence and what this means to each and every one of us. It's in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Take the words to ready our hearts for you and what you have for us in our